So the next talk is by Liu et al. And it's Chang'e 1, Observations of Magnetic Swirls. Or I suppose they don't have to be magnetic swirls, swirls.
Hi everyone, I'm David Liu from Chinese Academy of Science. Today I'm going to talk about the formation of lunar swirls. I will report some preliminary results from Chang'e 1 interference imaging spectrometer data. Lunar swirls are bright sinuous markings observed on the lunar surface. They have a higher albedo, They have a higher albedo than their surrounding areas. This bright region, we call it on-swirl regions, and this dark region, we call it off-swirl regions. As we can see, there's also some other area on the lunar surface with swirl regions. Lunar swirls are not associated with any topography, and all of swirls are correlated with magnetic anomalies. Many hypotheses have been proposed to explain the formation of lunar swirls. One leading hypothesis is a solar wind diffraction model. This model states that a magnetic field above lunar surface can deflect solar wind ions away from on-swirl surfaces and focus them onto off-swirl surfaces. A higher amount of some microscopic ion, we can also call it a nanophase ion, will be generated in off-swirl regions than on-swirl regions. We know that some microscopic ion can greatly lower the reflectance of lunar soils. That is why the on-swirl regions looks much brighter than off-swirl regions. According to this hypothesis, on-swirl regions should have a decreased solar wind flux and thus decrease some microscopic ion content. For off-swirl regions, they will receive increased solar wind flux and thus increase the generation of some microscopic ion. Based on this model, the objective of this research is to try to first develop a spectral model that can be used to estimate the mass fraction of some microscopic ion in lunar soils. And secondly, we want to apply this developed model to the measured reflex data and to test whether on-swirl regions are indeed deficient in mass fraction of submicroscopic ion than off-swirl regions. And if we can prove this, we can see the solar wind diffraction model is a valid hypothesis for the formation of lunar swirls. This slide shows the study area and the data site we used. Three lunar swirls are investigated. They are Rina Gamma in Mare regions, and also Fossil in Highland, and also part of Mare Igne was investigated. The locations and the magnetic anomaly strengths was also indicated in this table. The data site we used is from an image of Chang'e 1 LM level 2 readings data. They cover the central portion of the Rina Gamma, Fossil, and also part of Igne. All this data have been normalized to a standard viewing geometry. We also use the Moon Metrology Mapper reflected data for comparison. The key thing to test whether solar wind diffraction model is correct is try to develop a model that can be used to estimate mass fraction of some microscopic ion in lunar soils. To do this, we first check the live measured reflection data from Lunar Soil Characterization Consortium. These two figures show the measured reflectance of two soil samples of different particle size and also different composition. We can see that both of these two samples, they show their reflectance show a convergent at short wavelengths. So we thought this may be related to the strong effect of submicroscopic ion at this wavelength region. This wavelength region will not affected by the composition of lunar soils. Based on this observation, we try to make a correlation between the submicroscopic ion content and also the single scatter albedo for all these samples at 540 nanometers. Here, we use the single scatter albedo of the lunar soil samples rather than reflectance. It's because we think the submicroscopic ion can only coated on the surface of soil grains. They can affect the single scatter beetle, but without too much impact on the multiple scattering between different particles. So that is why we use a single scatter beetle rather than reflectance. We found that, in general, with increased content of some microscopic ion in lunar soils, the single scatter beetle of lunar soil decreased. However, there's not a good correlation between some microscopic ion and also single scatter beetle. This different color represent different size groups. For each size group, the single scatter beetle at 540 nanometers correlated well with the some microscopic ion. We think this is due to the particle size effect of soil grains. So we make a ratio between 540 nanometer single scatter beetle over 810 nanometer single scatter beetle. And we can see that the some microscopic ion content is relatively highly correlated with this ratio. The R squared can be up to 0.91. So we will use this model to apply it to the Chang'e data and try to estimate the mass fraction of some microscopic ion in lunar soils for several regions. The data set, as I mentioned, is Chang'e 1 level 2 radiance data. First, we converted to the reflectance data using this equation. Here, RSTD represents the lab measured reflectance of lunar soil samples 62231. And ISTD is the radiance data of Apollo 16 landing site extracted from Chang'e 1 LM data. And I is the radiance data of the several regions. And then we use Hapkis radial transfer model to convert the reflection data back to the single scatter beetle of lunar soils. After that, we can take this ratio, and then we can put this ratio into the equation we just derived and try to estimate the submicroscopic ion content in lunar soil regions. This is some result and discussion. The left side shows the image of original Chang'e 1 data. This is the false color images. And the right side shows the derived mass fraction of some microscopic ion for several regions. We can see that both Drina Gamma and the Furso, their unsewer regions shows the less content of some microscopic ion relative to off-sewer regions. And also, the dark lanes like this between the bright regions can be clearly depicted by the derived content of some microscopic ion. Also, the general shape of these swirls can be described by the content of some microscopic ion. Similar trend was also observed for Agni. We can see that the unswirl regions are relatively bright and they have a lower abundance of some microscopic ion relative to off-sewer regions. From the Chang'e data, we could say that the off-sewer regions evidently possess higher mass fraction of some microscopic ion than on-sewer regions. And the derived mass fraction of some microscopic ion, as we can see from previous slides, ranges from 0% to 0.7%. And this result is consistent with the measured data of lunar soils. It ranges from 0% almost to 1%. And also, we found that the swirl in highland regions, such as the Furso, they have a lower submicroscopic ion than in mare regions, such as the swirls in Drina Gamma and Angeny. I thought this may be due to the limited amount of ferrous ion to be reduced to some microscopic ion as a result of implanted solar wind hydrogen. We also conduct the same process to the M-cube data. Similarly, we can see that on sewer regions, they have a lower abundance of some microscopic ion than off sewer regions. And this is also also the shape can be clearly depicted by the mass fraction of some microscopic ion. And also, part of the engine, we see these lower regions of on-sewer region. So, based on the both M-cube data and also the Chang'e 1 data, we can conclude that off-sewer regions are really enriched in submicroscopic ion content, as proposed by the solar wind diffraction model. And because of magnetic field, fewer solar wind ions, especially hydrogen, they could penetrate into unswirled regions, and fewer ferrous ions will be reduced to submicroscopic ion, and then sputtered to form submicroscopic ion. The implanted hydrogen could be deflected onto offshore regions, and the resulting higher amount of submicroscopic ion to be accumulated in that region. Our results has already indicated the solar wind diffraction model is a validated hypothesis for the formation of lunar swirls. Actually, lunar swirls are very important natural laboratory to study the relative importance of solar wind implantation and micrometeorite bombardment on the process of space weathering. The observed content difference of submicroscopic ion between on and offshore regions could support the solar wind ion implantation model, maybe the major mechanism of space weathering, rather than micrometeorites. Otherwise, if we think micrometeorite impact is a major mechanism of space weathering, we would not observe the content difference of submicroscopic ion between on and offshore regions, because magnetic field, they can't block the micrometeorite impact. There will be equal amount of submicroscopic ion accumulated. Several studies have also indicated the enhanced water content in offshore regions than onshore regions. The association of increased submicroscopic ion content, as we found in this study, to the enrichment of the water in offshore regions could indicate the possibility of reduction of ferrous ion to submicroscopic ion by impinging solar wind, and also with the release of water or hydrogen. So it is worth for us to globally derive the abundance of submicroscopic ion and try to test whether there's a good correlation between this submicroscopic ion content and the some area with water already detected. If we can confirm this, we could use the in future work, we can use this submicroscopic ion content as an indicator to help us find the lunar surface areas with the possibility of presence of water. That's it all for me today's talk. Thank you.